You know, there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
Let's go. Make no excuses now. I'm talking here and now. I'm talking here and now. Let's go. Your time is running out. I'm talking here and now. I'm talking here and now. It's not about what you've done. It's about what you do it. It's all about where you're going, no matter where you've been. Let's go, go, go.
Hello, everybody. We're back with the BK Experience. We got Brookshire. We got Kai Reffer, we got my good friend Justin. Welcome to the show.
Here we go, glad to be a part.
So, Brookshire actually is attending to some very important business, and he asked me to come and share a couple of new laws for us. And I did bring a guest of mine, and his name is Justin.
Thank you for that warm introduction.
Justin actually works with Team Up for Life, our company. Mm-hmm. And we're actually going to be getting into the law of the inner circle. Ooh. And it's kind of interesting because the inner circle, we have an inner circle team member on the show today. And I'm going to get into talking to him a little bit and finding out some of his thoughts on these things. So first thing, I want to welcome all of you. We're back for another amazing week of the BK Experience. We've been here for a while. We've been doing some amazing things. We do have a win. We worked recently. We had Garen and Brian, which are the top leaders. Actually, they are Brian is the first African American president at Herbalife, and he was right here. And Garen is someone that's just joined the company recently, and I think is going to be the second black president of Herbalife. And we had a win, actually. We worked with them. We went into their organization and had a very powerful workshop for their teams. So some of you guys are tuning in from that. Some of you are Brookshire fans. You've been following the BK Experience for the longest time. Some of you are Kaya Redford fans. Some of you are just LA Talk Live Radio fans. Some of you are just fans of life. Go ahead and put your hand up if you're a fan of life. And if you love life and you love getting results, because that's what this show is about. It's about giving you tools and techniques to help you get results. So I would like to start off with, before I start off with the law of inner circle, I'd like to ask everybody, who do you know who the person with the highest recorded IQ in history is? I bet you're all thinking Albert Einstein or something, right? It's actually a woman called Marilyn Savant. Yes, it's a woman. Ooh. Marilyn Savant. And it's interesting, Marilyn was asked, you know, you're such a genius, you have the highest recorded IQ in history. Can you look at someone, can you meet someone in just a matter of a few moments, be able to ascertain or tell where they'll be in 10 years from now? She said, I would only need to ask two questions. Okay, are you asking me what those two questions are? You want to know what those
what
two questions
are?
What are those two questions? All right, the very first question was, she said, I would ask them, who are the five people you surround yourself with? Mm. Who are the five people that you spend most of your time with? Who are the five people that you associate with on the most regular basis? Because our results in life will be directly proportionate to the five people we surround ourselves with. I think you can play that full out and actually go ahead and find out what the income of maybe the five people that you associate mostly with. You don't have to play this as full out as that, but I think just to try it on, if you actually got the income of the five people you associate with and you averaged it, you might find yourself very close to where you're at. It's a perfect tie-in because we've been covering the 21 Irrefutable Laws of Leadership by John Maxwell. And we've been entering it into the frame of NLP and timeline therapy, which I'm a master trainer in. We've been addressing it in the context of a slightly different viewpoint, but really the same lessons. If I've mentioned it to you before, of the 21 laws of irrefutable leadership, there is a process in NLP and timeline therapy that actually will install about 19 of those. So what do I mean by install? What I mean is, you can read a book. How many of us have read a book? And then, yes, your way of thinking changed. But then a week later, you're back to the old, you know. Then you go, damn, I got to read that book again. And it's funny because you'll read that book like a 6 months or a year from now. And you're like, oh, my gosh, and I haven't been doing this. And I told myself I was going to do that. And I'm not doing that. And you start kicking yourself. And you got to read the book again. Why? Because the book is an intellectual book. It feeds the conscious mind. Very rarely will someone actually have an unconscious change, which means they will change from the inside out from having read a book. Because a book, even though it's an experience, it's not an actual experiential process or experience. So what we do is we talk about the 21 irrefutable laws of leadership with a slightly different pair of glasses, but they're the same laws. And today we're getting to the law of the inner circle. And I have Justin here, and Justin is definitely in my inner circle. And as a result of my inner circle, amazing inner circle team member, we're right now brokering a deal to actually heal millions of soldiers that are coming back from the wars in Afghanistan and in Iraq that are suffering from PTSD. So PTSD is post-traumatic stress disorder. And and let me tell you something, and Van is like,
because I've been diagnosed with that.
Okay, just so recently. We need to talk.
Sorry to hear that.
Just releasing. No, well,
it's good we're doing this.
Yes, yeah, it is. I don't know why you can't. You should be able to talk a little loud. You got to talk into the mic.
Okay.
Yeah,
right.
Talk into the mic.
I can hear you. Just got recently, like last week, diagnosed with that because I didn't believe or thought that it wasn't military related. Because I was in the military, that the stuff that I experienced wasn't quote unquote considered that type of illness or ailment.
Right.
You know? So
we've actually done the research now. The statistics now say there's more men and women that are returning from the wars that are committing suicide than have died in active combat in the last year. In 2012, more men and women returning veterans died of suicide than died in combat.
Terrible.
So it's a big problem. And as you know, NLP and timeline therapy, specifically timeline therapy techniques, actually goes to the root cause of a problem. PTSD is no different than any other problems that we work with. It's just a little deeper, different layer, and plucks that out, that problem out, almost like a weed out of the ground, so it won't grow back. So we're healing soldiers with it. So we have a lot of announcements with that, but let's tie this into what we're talking about. What we're talking about is the law of the inner circle, and a leader's potential is determined by those closest to him. So think about this. How many people really do it alone? How many people really build huge things by themselves? It's very, very rare that you see anybody of any stature build anything by themselves. It takes a team. Even if you've got a boxer who goes in the ring, think about a boxer who goes in the ring and it's a solo sport. Would you say boxing is a solo sport?
Mano a mano, yeah.
Solo. Mano a mano. Mm-hmm. But how do you think the boxer gets there to the title fight? Do you think he gets to a title fight just by knocking people out and that's it? No, he needs a trainer. He needs a nutritionist. He needs a manager. He needs a marketer. He needs a whole team of people that work with him. That get him ready. He needs the cut man. In fact, there's many times that I've heard some of the announcers say that sometimes the cut man, actually the quality of the cut man, when a boxer starts getting cut, and able to keep the swelling down in the face and able to suppress the bleeding, will actually make the difference between a fighter winning the fight and losing the fight. And that's the cut man. Okay, that's a doctor. So we know, and also take a look at even sports like basketball. I always talk about Jordan. Jordan's one of my favorite all-time basketball players. Mm-hmm. And remember when he was playing for himself? Remember the old days when Jordan was just insanely good and everybody was just looking at highlight reel after highlight reel, and it was all about him early days, similar to what Kobe Bryant was in the early, early days, kind of a little bit all about him.
Before the
what
same
happened?
Team.
Right. The Chicago Bulls got ousted in the playoffs by the Detroit Pistons twice. All right. It wasn't until Jordan matured in his leadership and he started to involve his inner circle, he started involving the team more, that he was able to create better results. So we know that the leader always has to deliver. However, the leader sometimes doesn't get an opportunity to deliver if he doesn't have a team around him to help put him in the position to deliver. So the law of the inner circle is very important. Mother Teresa's quote is saying, Mother Teresa, you can do what I cannot do. I can do what you cannot do. Together, we can do great things. So you want to surround yourself with people. So the question is, who do we surround ourselves with? A lot of times we find ourselves surrounding ourselves with people that we like or people that are like us.
Similar
to us. Is that effective? That we surround ourselves with people that we like and that people that are like us. Does that address effectiveness? Might it be more beneficial to surround ourselves with people that will help the mission become more effective?
Absolutely. Absolutely. People who are in alignment with our vision and who also can bring something to the table that will take our game to a whole nother level and help us play bigger.
Absolutely. So that's what we're talking about. Also, another example, have you ever seen celebrities that surround themselves, either an entertainment celebrity or a sports celebrity, that surround themselves with the wrong type of people?
Of course, yeah.
And they go downhill. Why? Because their inner circle is, you know, they're either, you know, taking drugs or they're bad influences. So there are people that you know, so you have to be very intentional with how you bring your inner circle in. So what are some things that we would want to ask ourselves? We want to ask ourselves about a person. Do they have influence with others? When you're thinking about your inner circle, you want to pick a person that has influence with others.
Absolutely.
Is it any good if they have no influence?
Nope.
To bring a bunch of followers on your team that have no way of enlisting anybody else means you just have to work harder. So do they have influence with others?
Can I evoke a little John Maxwell?
Yes.
Real quick. This just occurred to me that one of his quotes, one of my favorites of his, is that leaders create more leaders, not
yes.
just followers.
So yes.
Absolutely, 100%.
Yes, especially leaders that are effective, that want to leverage themselves. Yes, absolutely. Number two, what's the second question we might ask? Do they bring a complimentary gift to the table? In other words, do they have strengths in your or my area of weaknesses? Can I share with you like my thing? Absolutely. I'm not a numbers person. I hate spreadsheets. I hate accounting. I hate details, information. I just hate all of that stuff. I just can't deal with it. I do what I do well, and all the other stuff, I just can't handle it. So what do? I have brought in Mary. Mary's part of our team. Now, Mary is a cash flow strategist. She's a numbers person. She's an accountant. She does amazing things, and she's helped our business enormously. And she's just a different type of personality, but she fits her strengths compensate for my weaknesses.
We complement each other.
Complement each other. Yes.
She's very sharp.
Now, the third question you might ask is, do they hold a strategic position in the organization? So do they have a position through which strategically it can benefit the organization? Fourth question is, do they add value? Now, remember, John Maxwell is big on that, adding value. He talks about there are people that add value and there's people that they're adders and subtractors.
That's right.
Okay. But he also says that there are people that add so much that they end up multiplying. And there's people that subtract so fast and so furiously that it ends up not subtraction, it ends up dividing. Imagine if you had 100 and you subtract 10 each time from 100, you would go 90, 80, 70, 60, 50. But if you had someone dividing, what's 100 divided by 10? Imagine going from 100% effectiveness all the way down to 10% effectiveness because you have someone that's not even subtracting, they're dividing.
Ouch.
Ouch, right?
That's brutal.
It is brutal. So another person, a poem that Ellen Wheeler Wilcox shared with us, was there are two kinds of people on earth today, she says, two kinds of people. No more, I say, not the good or the bad, for 'tis well understood the good are half bad and the bad are half good. There's just two kinds of people. People that lift and people that lean. So we want to bring lifters. We want to bring lifters in your life. What is a lifter? A lifter is a person that when you interact with them, they lift your spirits up. You lift theirs, lift up the whole entire thing. So question is, number four question, would that be number five? This would be question number five. Do they positively impact on the inner circle members? In other words, have you ever added someone to your team that for you, you liked them, you related to them, but they created so many problems with other people? So in other words, what is the team chemistry like? We want to make sure that the chemistry is important. I feel like we have a great chemistry.
Absolutely. The word that comes to mind is synergy.
Synergy, yes.
Absolutely.
Yes. Tell us, what's synergy to you and what's chemistry in the area of business?
Well, I would say in the area of business, chemistry would relate more to just your personal relationship with that person, you know, between the two of you, right? How do you gel? I think that synergy typically applies to larger groups.
Synergy between the group.
The whole group, yes.
Yes.
And the whole is greater than the sum of its parts.
The whole is greater than the sum of its parts.
Right.
I think we need to get Justin on the show a little more often. I like it. I like
it.
So before we get to, we're going to wrap this up. Can I give you some suggestions on how to invoke, how to bring about the law of inner circle and apply it?
Okay.
Three steps. First, you want to list. You want to create a list of the members of your inner circle, and write down what each one contributes. Okay. If you don't know exactly what they contribute, just you know, with that belief, what do you believe that they contribute? Even if you don't really know, just like what do you believe they contribute? Write it down. Next thing is, what are the holes in that? What are the areas that are missing in their contribution? And also, what are the duplicates, which means what are things that you have too many people, too many chefs in the kitchen that are duplicating certain skill? And what you're going to do with that step one is you're going to begin to look for people that can fill in the holes,
right?
The gaps, and you're going to also find a way to challenge your team to, you know, maybe to get rid of or eliminate some of the redundancies. And channel people in a more complementary, you know, complementary way. So number two, what you want to do, step two, is you want to spend extra time with your members to mentor them and cultivate the relationship with them. When things go well, what do you want to do? What does John Maxwell say when things go well and when things go bad as a leader? What should you do?
The same thing.
The same thing. Well, yeah, I mean, when things are going well, you give other people credit.
Oh, there you go. Okay.
Right. When things go bad,
you take the responsibility.
You take the responsibility.
That's right.
So each step of the way, it's empowering people, and yet it's taking responsibility so that, you know, we'll get to that. The law of empowerment, actually, we're going to be getting to next. And the final step is, this is interesting. They say that it's good for your inner circle to be manageable, which means sometimes, have you ever had a situation where, well, I had an inner circle many years ago and it was 15 people. It was just too many people.
Wow.
So when it's not manageable because it's too many people, what you want to do is you want to scale it down to the magic number, seven. Seven is a magic number in so many different ways.
Yes, it is.
A team of seven. Not to say that's the only team. You have a team that's greater than that, but the inner circle, about seven. We had a lunch today regarding this show. Mm-hmm. We're going to do a documentary on PTSD. We're going to heal three soldiers of it. One that's suicidal, one that has chronic pain, and one that is addictive. So drug, substance abuse, alcohol abuse, whatever it is. And we had six people at the table. I felt there was a good number of people.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Yes. You can do a lot with that, but it's not too many.
It isn't too many.
Everybody had their piece to say, you know, but it wasn't overbearing.
Yeah, absolutely. Mm-hmm. So what are our final thoughts? What are your thoughts, final thoughts, Justin, on the law of inner circle? Or what do you...
Final thoughts on the law of the inner circle. That's such a broad topic, you know.
It is a broad topic.
And how do what's you narrow
one,
it down?
What's one thing, you know, Brookshire loves to ask this question. Mm-hmm. He asks, what do you know for sure? Out of everything we covered in the law of the inner circle, if you had to say one thing in 30 seconds, what would the one thing you would say, I know that for sure? What would that be?
You're growing or you're dying.
We are growing or dying.
And the people that you surround yourself with depend on which direction you're heading. So choose wisely.
Choose wisely. Yes. Yes. Yes, absolutely. Well, thank you very much. I think this is amazing first segment of the show. We covered the law of inner circle.
Yay. All right.
Woo. And we will be back in a few moments to talk about and to learn about the law of empowerment.
Stay tuned.
Stay tuned.
In the beginning, it all was written just how it would be to ending. And now it's playing out like a movie, no rewinding.
Do you suffer from degenerative diseases such as high blood pressure, diabetes, fibroid tumors, high cholesterol, genital herpes, or a plethora of other diseases that rob you of a quality life? If so, then visit the website of herbalist Tahuti Ma'atra at dhealthstore.com and open the door to natural healing at an affordable price. dhealthstore.com has over 1,800 products created by herbalist Tahuti Ma'atra, specifically designed to help you heal the natural and safe way. At DHealthStore.com, you'll find everything from herbal formulas and cleanses, such as Tahuti's famous Full Body Detox, as well as herbal teas, extracts, natural body butters, lotions, creams, children's products, hair care products, and of course, sexual enhancement products for both men and women. So visit the website of Tahuti Ma'atra, DHealthStore.com, or call toll free at 1-888-823-9416. DHealthStore.com.
Are you ready to enjoy the Maui lifestyle? You can have it all by owning real estate on the Paradise Island of Maui. Dennis Rush, a 22-year Maui resident and real estate broker, brings his wealth of experience and market knowledge to add value to your Maui real estate understanding, providing a level of service as unique and exceptional as the island of Maui itself. The magical island of Maui was voted the most exclusive resort island in the world by Condé Nast Traveler, and keep in mind, Maui is only a simple non-stop flight away. Hawaii Business Magazine Top 100 Realtors awarded Dennis Rush the 2011 fourth top realtor on the island of Maui. Go to www.dennisrush.com to view all of the amazing properties currently available in the Maui MLS system. Whatever your needs or desires, Dennis Rush will provide a private consultation for any Maui properties your heart desires. You will be in good hands. Once again, go to www.dennisrush.com. That's www.dennisrush.com. Contact Dennis today to start your Maui lifestyle now. Dennis Rush, proud sponsors of the Dawn Christie Show and LA Talk Live.
Hey, when the shit come on, y'all gotta chill. Y'all gotta chill. Feel like God is on his way when I spit this shit. Ha! Let's not argue. I won't harm you. Let's be balanced.
All right, we are back. We are back live at the BK Experience. We have a couple guests with us. Three guests with us in addition to Justin. We will introduce them on the next show. How about that? They are from France, and we're really looking forward to having both of you back here. And maybe we'll learn a little bit about the French language and what it's like to be in the entertainment industry. So we'll get to that. And we have Hayavi here too, Hayavi extraordinaire. So we're going to be getting to meet them at the next show. So you definitely want to tune in. Yes.
Yes, absolutely. Round of applause.
Yes. We actually met them today. And so we're excited to bring them on the next show. So we are now going to go into the law of empowerment. Now, let me ask you, who's one of the most famous people in automotive industry of all time in American business?
Henry Ford.
Henry Ford, yes. Do you know, little people actually know the story of Henry Ford. We know that, wow, okay, so he started the whole automobile industry. We know how famous the name is. It has a lot of reputation, has a lot of credibility. But we don't know much about certain things, certain practices. The law of empowerment, which is one of the 21 irrefutable laws of leadership, says only secure leaders give power to others. So let's go in and learn a little bit. Would you like to learn a little bit about Henry Ford?
Let's learn.
So Henry Ford was a pioneer, legend in automotive industry. In 1903, he co-founded. I actually thought he founded, but he actually co-founded the Ford Motor Company. And by 1914, the Ford Motor Company was producing about 50% of all the automobiles in the U.S. Now think about how much that is. That's an enormous amount, correct?
Yes.
But what people don't really know too much is that he had some issues. I don't know if it was an insecurity issue or something. He would actually undermine his leaders. Mm. Now, you may or may not know what we do. We have a program called Conflict Resolution. Mm-hmm. And in that program, very good friends, we've had the mayor of Ontario as our guest on the show, Mayor Paul Leung. And what we do is we work with different organizations that have some form of dysfunction. And we've come across some interesting things. Mm-hmm. We've come across organizations where, you know, it's almost like people feel that they're being watched. They're being recorded. Does this remind you of something? They're being recorded and there's a lack of trust. And you know, when things happen, you know, attorneys are brought in and just it's this sort of intimidating environment, a way of policing people to be a certain way. Might I also be saying that in a way off subject that in America that there's a slow process of us losing our power to being policed and watched, you know, for the state of security. And there's something about that is pretty uncomfortable, and I'm sure you would agree. We want to be protected, want to be safe, but to what degree? Mm. Now, what Henry Ford did is he would undermine his leaders because for some reason he felt this, insecurity. And he would go into their private lives and would do all this stuff, and a lot of people made them feel very uncomfortable. And it was at some point that his son, Edsel, who had been working there as a young kid, Henry Ford actually gave the presidency to his son, Edsel. Now, if you're promoting your son to be president of your company, would you undermine your own son?
No.
He was undermining his own son. And anytime anybody was going up the ranks in Ford Company, he would systematically, he would either transfer them, he would make a lateral move and put them in a position where they had no power. Build up their subordinates and undermine them. So he was just played a lot of weird politics, and a lot of people just hated him at that time, and were hoping that the father, would die because they figured the son would finally just say, "Look, I'm going to clean house and I'm not going to do it Dad's way anymore." Well, to everybody's surprise, in 1943, the son died at the age of 49.
No.
So left the father, still, and his craziness in control. And what was the person next in line to sort of take the reins was Henry Ford II, which was the grandson. And at that time, because of all the problems, they were losing a lot of money. The company at that time, had been the number one, automotive company, and it was systematically going down and down. It was losing about $1 million a day. Think about that in the, in the mid 1950s and 50s to be losing about you know, $1 million a day. And they, in fact, had not made a profit for 15 years. So imagine that. So they're having problems, correct?
Hmm.
Well, Henry Ford II, you know, he's in the Navy. He comes home and, you know, he's a young, you know, young kid. And what he does is he starts to seek the help and he looks for people outside of Ford to bring in the experts, the best people that he could think of. Well, it's actually a really smart decision. He went outside because he went to General Motors president and other individuals. He brought actually a very powerful team together. And over the next, say, 4, 5, 6 years, the Ford company went from losing money. Eventually, by 1949, it started to make money again. And in 1949, it actually had a record year where they sold about 1 million cars.
Wow.
They were poised almost to overtake General Motors. But again, what was present that was stopping them from going back to becoming number one again? The same issues. The grandson, it almost felt like Henry Ford II, the power he had was the name and the fact that the family controlled the stock. But every time they brought these powerful leaders in, they felt insecure. So they would get one executive against another executive and they would pit them against each other and you know, create all these types of problems.
Hmm.
So humiliating behavior. How many of you have ever heard of the name Lee Iacocca?
Absolutely.
He was actually a Ford president at one time. And he actually had spoken to Ford and he confided, actually, John Maxwell talks about this in this book. He confided in with Lee Iacocca and he actually told him, this is my way I work with my leaders. This is how I, you know, handle them. He says, if a guy works for you, this is Henry Ford Jr., right?
Okay.
If a guy works for you, don't let him get too comfortable.
Hmm.
Don't let him get too cozy or set in his ways. Always do the opposite of what he expects. Keep your people anxious and off balance.
That's
so
horrible.
Think about that. Is that the way to run a business? That may be the way to stay in control because you're unpredictable, but it certainly isn't the law of empowerment. So they didn't find leaders, build them up, give them all the tools to become successful and position them for success. Instead, they undermine them. John Maxwell talks about the two games that we learned. I mean, I didn't learn them because I grew up in Europe, but I think in the U.S. there's King of the Hill, and he mentions follow the leader. King of the Hill, what's the purpose of King of the Hill? Have you ever played King of the Hill?
It's been a long time, Kai.
I guess you get on a hill and you beat other people down so that they can't be on the hill. So you fight other people so they can't come to the top of the hill. That's how you play King of the Hill.
Right.
It's not really Sounds empowering. Right.
Not at all.
Okay. And then what's the other one? Follow the leader, which has something to do with you do something that is impossible for other people to duplicate. So you separate yourself from them so they can't do what you do. These are some of the games. I know they might be fun that we might have learned or heard about as kids. But what do they all have in common?
Kind of divisive.
Like divisive, kind of like a scary, like scarcity mindset, fear
scarcity
mindset.
Mentality.
Right?
I'm going to get mines.
So there's issues. And so let's talk about some of the common barriers to empowerment. What are some of the common barriers to empowerment? Number one, desire for job security. Now, I had a family member actually that told me this probably about 5 years ago. And was working in Silicon Valley and, you know, kind of the tech industry. And he got a job. Mm-hmm. And, you know, they're bringing people. He said, I don't want to tell these new people everything I know. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, okay, sure, tell me why. He says, well, if I tell them everything I'll know, then they'll do the job better than me, and then they'll get rid of me. Mm-hmm. So think about that as a leader. What kind of mindset is it where you would keep things from other people that are coming in because you're fear of being replaced? So what John Maxwell is talking about, what I totally agree with as well, is that people are worried about being dispensable.
Mm-hmm.
But the thing is, until you make yourself create leaders within you such that you are dispensable in a way, you're not really ever dispensable because people will notice. There's a paradox that. there. When people notice that you keep getting results, every time people come on your team, you get results. Yes, there's other people that can actually step in your shoes and do what you do, but you created that. Mm-hmm. Under your leadership, you created leaders and you duplicated yourself. It may not work where every single time it's noticed, but over a career, the person that constantly builds people to be effective just like them, it's going to get noticed and it's going to get rewarded. So there's almost like a paradox and a confusion about job security. People think they need to hold other people back so that they're secure at their job. And it's actually not that. It's letting people go and evolve and grow into your abilities that actually in the long run actually will get you promoted to being, you know, where you can possibly be and what you can absolutely do.
In the long run.
So in the long run. The sum.
Is greater.
The sum of your leadership mm-hmm. over a lifetime is greater than the moments when you try to hold people back to shine yourself.
Exactly. And either way, there's going to be a long run impact. The question is, do you want people who are empowered and to get results, or do you want people who hate you?
Exactly. Yes. And there's enough, you know, if Brookshie was here right now, he'd say, hey, there's enough hate in the world. Y'all know this. So we need to come from a little more love. I've tried to say it like Brookshie way. But I miss you, Brookshie. He's tuning in. He's handling some big business. We miss you. And he may call in. I hope he does call in.
Please call Brookshie.
Please call Brookshie. call us in. Okay, so what are two other barriers? Barriers to empowerment. Resistance to change. Oh, my gosh.
Big one.
We are creatures of habit. So many people don't want to change. Mm-hmm. But as a leader, what do you got to do? It's change. You're either growing or dying, just what you said. Mm-hmm. So you constantly change to improve. I always say this whenever you know this, Justin, because every single meeting we do, I ask two questions. After every single meeting, I ask two questions. When the meeting is done, I say, what worked?
Mm.
What were the three things that worked?
Mm-hmm.
What were the three things that were good, that were positive, that helped? What were the three things that worked? Everybody shares that. So it sends everything in a positive direction. Then I say, what could be improved. I don't go what didn't work, but what could be improved. And that's when every single meeting we find out something that didn't quite, you know, it could have been improved, and we actually create change. Meeting to meeting, every meeting there's a change and evolution in how we do something to get better. So change is important. What's a third barrier? So people being resistant to change is the second barrier. What's a third barrier? Lack of what? A lack of self-worth. You know what I mean? Mm. Can I be honest with you all? I used to be insecure. Maybe you've tuned into some other shows that I've done and know a little bit about the past, but I used to be blind. I used to be asleep. I used to be what I call a zombie. I was walking around with so many issues before I learned NLP and timeline therapy and was able to clean up myself. That I was, you know, really insecure. I had no self-worth. I at some point in my life, I was hoping, you know, prior to the age of 33, I would say prior to the age of 33, I didn't know who I was. I didn't know what my purpose was. I had no direction. I was just, you know, an unhappy camper. I had no self-worth. So really for me to be able to lead, to empower, would require me to be able to see something in myself and see something in other people. And I just couldn't do that. Because I just didn't have any self-worth. So let me ask you this. If you think, if a person is insecure in themselves, would that be a barrier to empowering other people? Can you give anybody else something you don't see that you have yourself?
Absolutely not.
You know, Marianne Williamson, another person I love, she says, only what you give to yourself, what you have yourself, can you give to someone else? And she also says the flip reverse, only what you're not giving to someone else is actually what you're not giving to yourself. It's kind of interesting. So a lack of self-worth. So who is a person in history? You know, I went to Washington recently, about a month ago. And actually, first time, you know, I grew up in Europe. I was born in the U.S. in Nebraska, but I grew up in Europe up until, 20? And then I came back to the U.S. around 20 years old. So I missed American history. And I got to go to the White House about a month ago. I got to go to the Lincoln Memorial. I got to see Abraham Lincoln's top hat. And just and then I watched the movie, and then I started doing some research, and John Maxwell talks about him too. And, you know, it's interesting because there is a president who actually surrounded himself with all the pretty much all the people that disagreed with him. You know, there was a reporter that at that time it said, he said, a biographer of Lincoln, he said, for a president to select a political rival for a cabinet post was not unprecedented. So for a president to select a political rival, someone who is rivaling him for a cabinet post was not unprecedented. But to deliberately, this is what he said, but to deliberately surround himself with all of his disappointed antagonists seemed to be courting disaster. What Lincoln did is he surrounded himself with people that, you know, were as strong as him. He didn't come from fear. Remember we talked about the King of the Hill, and we talked about the other game, which is Follow the Leader, which comes from fear. I've got to show you that I have more, that I can do more than you and keep you down. What Lincoln did is he did the reverse. He brought people in that, you know, could check him, that could challenge him, that could bring things to the table, that could even rock the boat. Why? Because he had security in himself. And there was a famous story in June of 1863, a general that was in charge of the battle in Gettysburg was being sent out to handle the Battle of Gettysburg. And Lincoln actually sent a letter to this via messenger to this general. And in this letter, he said, I'm sort of paraphrasing, he said, considering the circumstances, no one has ever received a more important command, and I cannot doubt that you will be fully that you will fully justify the confidence when the government has reposed in you. So you will fully justify the confidence that we have in you. You will not be hampered by any minute instructions from those headquarters. Your army is free to act as you deem proper under the circumstances that they arise. All forces within the sphere of our operations will be held and subject to your order. Here's a president saying, you know what, to his general in the army of, in the Battle of Gettysburg, I trust you. Whatever you want to do, you got this.
Wow.
We will not interfere. We will not tell you what to do. We will not send you orders. We will not try to coach you from the sidelines. We will not try to tell you no change to battle plan. We will leave it up to you because we trust you that much. And as history records, you know, they won, right? So you get to see Lincoln and you get to see, or I'll go, you get to see Lincoln and you get to see Ford. Completely different leadership styles. One person is empowering. Lincoln's empowering, and another leader is
disempowering.
And we do have a couple of steps to help, but what do you want to share?
Wow.
What's something that you, in other words, of everything that we've talked about, what is something that you know for sure?
Something that I know for sure. Well, yes. You have bosses and you have leaders.
Yes.
Right? And so many people in the corporate structure and other areas, which is why they get such a bad rap and people are so, you know, hesitant to go into work so many times, has to do with that mentality that the boss will try to keep other people down and maintain their power and position, King of the Hill, as you call it, like the game. And then you have leaders who actually empower those around them. So ask yourself, are you the boss or are you the leader? And how can you minimize the boss within you and elevate the leader?
Absolutely. That's a fantastic point. You know, you remind me, Justin, of the law firm that we did a few years back. So bossing. People, you can tell people what to do, or you can ask them to do it. And what's more effective? I think there, if you go into it deep, there's a certain amount of bossing is necessary. But what happens is you're probably saying that most people that are in that position, they're bossing, they're doing too much bossing and no asking. So yes, sometimes you just got to tell them, you got to do this and you got to get it done now, period. I don't need questions. You just need to go. Because imagine a firefighter trying to ask, or a police officer trying to ask in emergency, or anybody in the emergency business, okay? You can't pretty much sit around and ask questions while the person dies on you. You got to just tell them, put the decaffeiner in there and do this and do that. You got, there's sense of urgency with certain situations, but more asking. So let's go over steps. People are hearing this and you're thinking, okay, law of impairment. I get it. But what do I do? What are the steps to invoking the law of impairment? Okay, ready? I want you, step one, I want you to rate yourself in terms of your own self-worth. Remember, we talked about self-worth as it could be a barrier. So rate yourself upon your self-worth. Question is, question one, are you confident? Do you believe you have value? Do you assume that you have positive things to offer people? And finally, are you willing to take risks? Question is, after you've asked yourself those, if you rate yourself low, start to take steps to add value to yourself and build your self-worth up. Actually, I would suggest you come to our workshops. We have a NLP workshop that installs confidence and self-worth and self-esteem and mission and vision and all that, which is going to be May 17, 18, and 19. And our guest here, Hayavi, to my right, is going to be attending all 9 days. So I'm excited about that. So you want to rank yourself and rate yourself on that question. And if you see that, you know, I got some work to do on me, then just do the work. Come to a seminar. Okay? Contact us. Go to Love 923. Go see Brookshire. Or come to www.kayaredfordcoaching.com. Or contact us directly at 310-871-6191. That's 310-871-6191. All right, so that's step one. Step two is make a list of people that work for you and rate each person's potential on a scale of 1 to 10. Once you've rated them on a scale of 1 to 10, look at your answers. If you've rated them low, then you need to maybe check your belief in the people that work for you, because that's part of the problem. If you're rating them low, how on earth can you ever grant them any power if you see that they are powerless or you see that they have no potential? So that's a reflection back on you as the leader to take a look at how am I putting them in that low category, and how is my perception of them creating a reality that I don't want? And step three, final step, is select your best people, give them the resources and the skills and everything that you can, and help them grow with you. So really focus on building the best people with the best tools and creating the best project or company or organization that you can possibly have. So we're wrapping it up. I know we have any final thoughts, Justin? We got about 30 seconds left that you wanted to share on the law of empowerment, or something that you wanted to, something else that you know for sure for the listening audience?
Well, I have to say one thing that I respect about you, one of the reasons I'm here and involved in the team, is that I noticed that about you, that you do empower people. And I've seen the power that can come from that and all of the things that arise. And I think that there's just so much more that's possible for somebody who empowers others, as opposed to disempowering others. And in our culture, we're taught, you know, to disempower. We're taught to be powerless and learned helplessness. But what you're doing with the seminar and the programs and everything that we're working on, these projects, PTSD, it all comes together in order to make the world better.
Yes.
So if you want the best within you so that you can give the best to others,
yes,
I would highly recommend being involved in this in any way possible.
Yes. Well, there you go, listeners, viewers. I want to thank Van for making us look good.
Thank you.
Keeping the audio and all that going. And I want to thank Justin for being our guest today. I think I'd like to invite Justin back. Do you all agree? Justin had some really good points. He's got a great energy. Love to bring Justin back. And on a subsequent show, we will have our guests from France. We actually have an entertainment show after this one that's entertainment related. Real talk with Brookshire, right?
Yes, indeedy.
So maybe they could come on as guests of that show.
No, well, I was informed.
Well, not today, but...
Not today, yeah, but on another time.
Yes.
We're going to put the episode of January the 27th.
Okay.
That's when the Power Rangers...
Power Rangers, okay.
...was on a guest.
Okay, awesome.
Yes.
Awesome.
So.
Well, we love them Power Rangers. You know why? Because it's power. All right, so... Again, take all these things. Here's the thing. Infuse them, use them, apply them in your life. It's the law of process. It's not what you do all in a day. It's what you do day by day, that will build your legacy and your future. And that's what we're all about. Next week, we'll have Brookshire here. I'll be back. And we'll have some new guests. And we'll have an exciting show. And we'll be continuing doing the 21 Irrefutable Laws of Leadership with a new twist and a new flavor and a new color and a new dimension. And giving you steps. God bless. Good night. Have a kick-ass week. See you next weekend.
Summer's love shines bright, bringing me back to life. My heart's like the open field for you. You always